Harper Audio presents A Series of Unfortunate Events, Book the Fifth, The Austere Academy, written and performed by Lemony Snicket. For Beatrice, you will always be in my heart, in my mind, and in your grave. Chapter 1. If you were going to give a gold medal to the least delightful person on earth, you would have to give that medal to a person named Carmelita Spatz. And if you didn't give it to her, Carmelita Spatz was the sort of person who would snatch it from your hands anyway. Carmelita Spatz was rude, she was violent, and she was filthy. And it is really a shame that I must describe her to you, because there are enough ghastly and distressing things in this story without even mentioning such an unpleasant person. It is the Baudelaire orphans, thank goodness, who are the heroes of this story, not the dreadful Carmelita Spatz. And if you wanted to give a gold medal to Violet, Klaus, and Sunny Baudelaire, it would be for survival in the face of adversity. Adversity is a word which here means trouble, and there are very few people in this world who have had the sort of troubling adversity that follows these three children wherever they go. Their trouble began one day when they were relaxing at the beach and received the distressing news that their parents had been killed in a terrible fire, and so were sent to live with a distant relative named Count Olaf. If you were going to give a gold medal to Count Olaf, you would have to lock it up someplace before the awarding ceremony, because Count Olaf was such a greedy and evil man that he would try to steal it beforehand. The Baudelaire orphans did not have a gold medal, but they did have an enormous fortune that their parents had left them, and it was that fortune Count Olaf tried to snatch. The three siblings survived living with Count Olaf, but just barely, and since then Olaf had followed them everywhere, usually accompanied by one or more of his sinister and ugly associates. No matter who was caring for the Baudelaires, Count Olaf was always right behind them, performing such dastardly deeds that I can scarcely list them all. Kidnapping, murder, nasty phone calls, disguises, poison, hypnosis, and atrocious cooking are just some of the adversities the Baudelaire orphans survived at his hands. Even worse, Count Olaf had a bad habit of avoiding capture, so he was always sure to turn up again. It is truly awful that this keeps happening, but that is how the story goes. I only tell you that the story goes this way because you are about to become acquainted with rude, violent, filthy Carmelita Spatz, and if you can't stand reading about her, you would best put this book down and read something else, because it only gets worse from here. Before too long, Violet, Klaus, and Sunny Baudelaire will have so much adversity that being shoved aside by Carmelita Spatz will look like a trip to the ice cream store.
"Get out of my way, you cake sniffers!"
said a rude, violent, and filthy little girl, shoving the Baudelaire orphans aside as she dashed by. Violet, Klaus, and Sunny were too startled to answer. They were standing on a sidewalk made of bricks, which must have been very old because there was a great deal of dark moss oozing out from in between them. Surrounding the sidewalk was a vast brown lawn that looked like it had never been watered, and on the lawn were hundreds of children running in various directions. Occasionally someone would slip and fall to the ground, only to get back up and keep running. It looked exhausting and pointless, two things that should be avoided at all costs, but the Baudelaire orphans barely glanced at the other children, keeping their eyes on the mossy bricks below them. Shyness is a curious thing, because like quicksand, it can strike people at any time, and, also like quicksand, it usually makes its victims look down. This was to be the Baudelaire's first day at Prufrock Preparatory School, and all three siblings found that they would rather look at the oozing moss than at anything else.
"Have you dropped something?"
Mr. Poe asked, coughing into a white handkerchief. One place the Baudelaire certainly didn't want to look was at Mr. Poe, who was walking closely behind them. Mr. Poe was a banker who had been placed in charge of the Baudelaire's affairs following the terrible fire, and this had turned out to be a lousy idea. Mr. Poe meant well, but a jar of mustard probably also means well and would do a better job of keeping the Baudelaires out of danger. Violet, Klaus, and Sunny had long ago learned that the only thing they could count on from Mr. Poe was that he was always coughing. "No," Violet replied, "we haven't dropped anything." Violet was the oldest Baudelaire, and usually she was not shy at all. Violet liked to invent things, and one could often find her thinking hard about her latest invention, with her hair tied up in a ribbon to keep it out of her eyes. When her inventions were done, she liked to show them to people she knew, who were usually very impressed with her skill. Right now, as she looked down at the mossy bricks, she thought of a machine she could build that could keep moss from growing on the sidewalk, but she felt too nervous to talk about it. What if none of the teachers, children, or administrative staff were interested in her inventions? As if he were reading her thoughts, Klaus put a hand on Violet's shoulder and she smiled at him. Klaus had known, for all 12 of his years, that his older sister found a hand on her shoulder comforting, as long as the hand was attached to an arm, of course. Normally, Klaus would have said something comforting as well, but he was feeling as shy as his sister. Most of the time, Klaus could be found doing what he liked to do best, which was reading. Some mornings one could find him in bed with his glasses on because he had been reading so late that he was too tired to take them off. Klaus looked down at the sidewalk and remembered a book he had read called Moss Mysteries, but he felt too shy to bring it up. What if Prufrock Preparatory School had nothing good to read? Sunny, the youngest Baudelaire, looked up at her siblings, and Violet smiled and picked her up. This was easy to do, because Sunny was a baby and only a little bit larger than a loaf of bread. Sunny was also too nervous to say anything, although it was often difficult to understand what she said when she did speak up. For instance, if Sunny had not been feeling so shy, she might have opened her mouth, revealing her four sharp teeth, and said, "Marimo!" which may have meant, "I hope there are plenty of things to bite at school, because biting things is one of my favorite things to do."
"I know why you're all so quiet," Mr. Poe said. "It's because you're excited, and I don't blame you. I always wanted to go to boarding school when I was younger, but I never had the chance. I'm a little jealous of you, if you want to know the truth."
The Baudelaires looked at one another. The fact that Prufrock Preparatory School was a boarding school was the part that made them feel the most nervous. If no one was interested in inventions, or there was nothing to read, or biting wasn't allowed, not only all day, but all night as well. The siblings wished that if Mr. Poe were really jealous of them, he would attend Prufrock Preparatory School himself, and they could work at the bank.
"You're very lucky to be here," Mr. Poe continued. "I had to call more than 4 schools before I found one that could take all 3 of you at such short notice. Prufrock Prep, that's what they call it as sort of a nickname, is a very fine academy. The teachers all have advanced degrees. The dormitory rooms are all finely furnished. And most important of all, there is an advanced computer system which will keep Count Olaf away from you. Vice Principal Nero told me that Count Olaf's complete description, everything from his one long eyebrow to the tattoo of an eye on his left ankle, has been programmed into the computer. So you 3 should be safe here for the next several years."
"But how can a computer keep Count Olaf away?" Violet asked in a puzzled voice, still looking down at the ground.
"It's an advanced computer," Mr. Poe said, as if the word advanced were a proper explanation instead of a word meaning having attained advancement. "Don't worry your little heads about Count Olaf. Vice Principal Nero has promised me that he will keep a close eye on you. After all, a school as advanced as Prufrock Prep wouldn't allow people to simply run around loose."
"Move, cake sniffers!"
the rude, violent, and filthy little girl said as she dashed by them again.
"What does cake sniffers mean?" Violet murmured to Klaus, who had an enormous vocabulary from all his reading. "I don't know," Klaus admitted, "but it doesn't sound very nice."
"What a charming word that is," Mr. Poe said. "Cake sniffers. I don't know what it means, but it reminds me of pastry. Oh well, here we are."
They had come to the end of the mossy brick sidewalk and stood in front of the school. The Baudelaires looked up at their new home and gasped in surprise. Had they not been staring at the sidewalk the whole way across the lawn, they would have seen what the academy looked like. Perhaps it was best to delay looking at it for as long as possible. A person who designs buildings is called an architect, but in the case of Prufrock Prep, a better term might be depressed architect. The school was made up of several buildings, all made of smooth gray stone, and the buildings were grouped together in a sort of sloppy line. To get to the buildings,
the Baudelaires had to walk beneath an immense stone arch, casting a curved shadow on the lawn, like a rainbow in which all of the colors were gray or black. On the arch were the words, "Prufrock Preparatory School," in enormous black letters, and then, in smaller letters, the motto of the school, "Memento Mori." But it was not the buildings or the arch that made the children gasp. It was how the buildings were shaped, rectangular, but with a rounded top. A rectangle with a rounded top is a strange shape, and the orphans could only think of one thing with that shape. To the Baudelaires, each building looked exactly like a gravestone.
"Rather odd architecture," Mr. Poe commented. "Each building looks like a thumb. In any case, you are to report to Vice Principal Nero's office immediately. It's on the 9th floor of the main building."
"Aren't you coming with us, Mr. Poe?" Violet asked. Violet was 14, and she knew that 14 was old enough to go to somebody's office by herself. But she felt nervous about walking into such a sinister-looking building without an adult nearby. Mr. Poe coughed into his handkerchief and looked at his wristwatch at the same time.
"I'm afraid not," he said when his coughing passed. "The banking day has already begun. But I have talked over everything with Vice Principal Nero, and if there's any problem, remember you can always contact me or any of my associates at Mokesuary Money Management. Now, off you go. Have a wonderful time at Prufrock Prep."
"I'm sure we will," said Violet, sounding much braver than she felt. "Thank you for everything, Mr. Poe." "Yes, thank you," Klaus said, shaking the banker's hand. "Turfunt," Sunny said, which was her way of saying thank you.
"You're welcome, all of you," Mr. Poe said. "So long."
He nodded at all three Baudelaires, and Violet and Sunny watched him walk back down the mossy sidewalk, carefully avoiding the running children. But Klaus didn't watch him. Klaus was looking at the enormous arch over the academy. "Maybe I don't know what cake sniffer means," Klaus said, "but I think I can translate our new school's motto." "It doesn't even look like it's in English," Violet said, peering up at it. "Racho," Sunny agreed. "It's not," Klaus said. "It's in Latin. Many models are in Latin for some reason. I don't know very much Latin, but I do remember reading this phrase in a book about the Middle Ages. If it means what I think it means, it's certainly a strange motto." "What do you think it means?" Violet asked. "If I'm not mistaken," said Klaus, who was rarely mistaken, "Memento Mori means, remember you will die." "Remember you will die," Violet repeated quietly, and the three siblings stepped closer to one another, as if they were very cold. "Everybody will die, of course, sooner or later. Circus performers will die, and clarinet experts will die, and you and I will die. And there might be a person who lives on your block right now who is not looking both ways before he crosses the street and who will die in just a few seconds, all because of a bus. Everybody will die, but very few people want to be reminded of that fact." The children certainly did not want to remember that they would die, particularly as they walked beneath the arch over Prufrock Prep. The Baudelaire orphans did not need to be reminded of this as they began their first day in the giant graveyard that was now their home. Chapter 2. As the Baudelaire orphans stood outside Vice Principal Nero's door, they were reminded of something their father said to them just a few months before he died. One evening, the Baudelaire parents had gone out to hear an orchestra play, and the three children had stayed by themselves in the family mansion. The Baudelaires had something of a routine on nights like this. First, Violet and Klaus would play a few games of checkers while Sunny ripped up some old newspapers, and then the three children would read in the library until they fell asleep on comfortable sofas. When their parents came home, they would wake up the sleeping children, talk to them a little about the evening, and send them off to bed. But on this particular night, the Baudelaire parents came home early and the children were still up reading, or in Sunny's case, looking at the pictures. The siblings' father stood in the doorway of the library and said something they never forgot. "Children," he said, "there is no worse sound in the world than somebody who cannot play the violin, who insists on doing so anyway." At the time, the Baudelaires had merely giggled, but as they listened outside the vice principal's door, they realized that their father had been absolutely right. When they first approached the heavy wooden door, it sounded like a small animal was having a temper tantrum. But as they listened more closely, the children realized it was somebody who cannot play the violin, insisting on doing so anyway. The sound shrieked and hissed and scratched and moaned and made other horrible sounds that are really impossible to describe. And finally, Violet could take it no longer and knocked on the door. She had to knock very hard and at length in order to be heard over the atrocious violin recital going on inside. But at last the wooden door opened with a creak, and there stood a tall man with a violin under his chin and an angry glare in his eyes.
"Who dares interrupt the genius when he is rehearsing?"
he asked, in a voice so loud and booming that it was enough to make anyone shy all over again. "The Baudelaires," Klaus said quietly, looking at the floor.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.